Okay. Recording is on.
All right. So maybe starting with Juliet and Karen, if we have any open issues.
I don't think that we do, but I don't want to speak for Juliet.
Don't have any open issues. I did promise to give an update on the number of cafe permits that have been renewed or have been requested to be renewed to November 1, extended. And we
All
have
right.
about half, about 20 businesses are working on an extension to November 1st. And we had approved about 40 permits during the regular season. So about half of them are trying to extend to November 1st. We are, if the council decides to vote to extend it further, we are just leaving the term open-ended so that we don't have to go through this process again. It's actually behind the scenes quite a tedious process for the legal department to revise all these agreements. So we will look to make that a little easier next year, I think, if we do this again. But in the meantime, we are working with 20 folks to go to November 1st. And most of them also are adding heaters if they haven't already.
And are working with the fire department to make sure they're compliant. This Thursday, in anticipation of potentially extending the use for restaurants beyond November 1st, the staff is going to meet internally to talk about what that might look like. But again, as Juliet mentioned, it has been something the council will talk about at their October 19th meeting.
And I know Valerie's not here today, but there's been activity and interest from restaurants to remain open beyond November 1st. At the last council meeting, I said that we hadn't heard of interest beyond November 1st, but it's clear that there is interest at this point.
Right, maybe it's helpful. He sent out an email to all potentially interested parties to ask the question of them if they wanted the ability to continue. How would you envision doing so? So that email to restaurants went out on Friday the 9th. And I know that even though she's not around, she is on vacation, she's working to compile that information, and we'll have a formal meeting with them a week from tomorrow to finalize and put together what their stance might be.
All right, and I think the what's been in the news the last couple of days with some restaurants closing for cautionary reasons, and Jumpin' Jay's having a case that may be influencing an interest in attempting to remain outdoors longer. I think I'm kind of speculating, but I think that's probably going to occur.
You're going to reach out one more time to any of the businesses we haven't heard back from yet. So, or at least one more time. I want to get a confirmed no or yes, because some people don't have time to respond. So that we have to prod them a little bit. So I'll have another update next week. That'll be after the expiration of their current permit.
Thanks, Juliet. Juliet, you mentioned that it's tedious for the city. Is it tedious for the restaurants, or is it?
I wouldn't say it's. We try to make it as easy as possible, but it does require signing an extension of their service agreement, which is just a back and forth that has to happen between the legal department and a member of their staff. Usually it's the owner. And that's, I think next year we can figure out other ways to handle this more effectively. One of the things the city's looking into is just enabling us to have DocuSign procedures so that we don't have to do this back and forth with documents. Our online permitting really helps make this a lot faster, but just little things like legal documents signing off and stuff like that still can take some time back and forth. So,
Right.
but our we have a very a great assistant in the legal department who's on top of all this, so she's been doing a lot of follow-up with people.
Great. Yeah, DocuSign works well.
Yeah.
So, what else is on this group's agenda? I'm the substitute teacher. So, you know.
Well, that
So
means
if
you have to wreak havoc with the chairman, I guess.
Go ahead, Alan.
James, if I may, I just got a real-time message from Valerie Rochon. Said only three responses from restaurants so far, one with two tables on the sidewalk that wants the ability to put those tables out throughout the winter on nice days, two others with more outside tables who want the same. Only one is in the street. I've asked him for more details to share with the task force. So I don't have names in this, but responses are trickling in.
Okay. And I would say there is a distinction in the downtown. There are some people who have tables and chairs out on the sidewalk through what we call our sidewalk obstruction license, which is assuming that there's no service to those tables. So that obstruction license technically does not have an expiration date. It gets renewed in March. Mm-hmm. So as long as they aren't interfering with normal operations of the city, they can continue to do that and have those tables out throughout the mm-hmm. year. There's no real restrictions on that. Obviously, you know, we would want to make sure they're removing them for snow removal and stuff like that. It's the ones that are actually having service at those locations that we need to do these service agreements with. And those would be the ones that expire on November 1 if they choose to extend to them.
And that's probably a message. That's probably a message we should get back to Valerie. I mean, I'm sure she's aware, but that's a distinction that I think could easily get missed with the request flying around.
Yeah. Other than that, Mr. Substitute Chairman, I don't think we have anything else from the city end of the world.
Okay. Anyone else?
I don't know if Ann has any fun examples from elsewhere to share.
Or a bon mot or two.
I can say you should all follow the Winter Cities Institute on Facebook.
Winter Cities Institute.
It was a very quiet Facebook page until maybe 2 weeks ago. I mean, it's not a COVID page. It's Canada and Scandinavia is who seems to be the members of it. And they just throw stuff on it. It's interesting to see the pictures they put up.
So one thing that I want to bring out at our full task force meeting tomorrow, but maybe I'll get a head start with this group, is that the city's having a public work session on November 9th, a Monday, on the topic of the COVID citizen response task force. Karen, can you educate me, and maybe others will benefit from it too. What's a work session process like? Does an agenda get developed? How do people participate? Can you just give us the ABCs of how that's going to work?
I can do my best, but I look for my colleagues to fill in. It's my understanding that work sessions typically have one item on the agenda, and this would be the what happens with the Citizen Response Task Force after its expiration on December 31st. It's my understanding city staff present and have back and forth with council, and this council has chosen to include a public comment section as part of the work session, and I think it usually comes after the presentation, but this one may be different in that it may help inform what the council talks about. So I'm gonna look to any of my colleagues to see if they have any thoughts differently from this. Hard to say.
You nailed it pretty well. I mean, it's an opportunity for the commission, the committee and the council to have dialogue to try to flesh out, you know, where they wanna go. And they do, yeah, the public process, there's no votes taken at that meeting. So it's really just a opportunity to kind of do what ifs and kick things around. So.
Yeah, that's an important distinction. I'm glad you brought that up, Peter. I think the council is truly trying to figure out what is the best approach to continuing this effort. So I think to that end, it would be great if members of the task force would be able to join by Zoom and share their feedback, share their comments, good, bad, what works, what doesn't.
Okay. And is it a 6:30 start time?
It is 6:30. They typically go 2 hours, but That remains to be seen.
Okay. All right. Thank you for that. All right. Any other business for this group?
I see Bianca's joined us, and she typically, I don't know that I see her typically at street use. So I don't know if Bianca, if you through the chair had anything you wanted to bring up, or you're just giving us your time today.
No, yeah. So I just joined because I just wanted to bring something real quick that I talked on the other meeting on the health subcommittee, and I kind of got so excited. And I was talking to Andrew after the meeting. I said I should bring it up. Let me join.
Bianca, your audio is a little off. Maybe your speaker's too close, or.
Okay. Can you hear me?
We can hear you, but it's a little fuzzy.
A bit attenuated.
Let me see my mic here. My mic seems to be okay.
All right. We can hear you well enough, but not as well as we usually hear you.
I'm excited about it, so I'm going to carry you over about my idea. So we talked at the end of the health subcommittee about ideas on what could we do in the winter in a safe way to continue a vibrant city and vibrant business, right? So I kind of thought about, and this could be just a complete dream on my, of my part, but sort of consider the main downtown area, right? The main streets as sort of almost like a ski village, right? When you think about Vail, when you think about Whistler, they have pretty wide streets that can still trucks, the health department and the fire and police could still access, and it's safe enough, but we still could have mostly pedestrian to have still outdoor events and still be safe enough for, you know, the utility trucks to go by. And on that, even if we didn't have a terrible winter, if we could have still sort of everything happening outside from events, from restaurants and all this, right?
Yeah, that's an exciting proposal. So should we vote on it? I think.
Excited, right, James?
No, I get excited about that idea, and I have in the past over the years. And then there's some folks that are not so excited about it. But I think this group should be tasked with really, really kind of fleshing that out. And what are the, you know, I think we've talked briefly and we've gotten some input from you, Peter, on what some of the challenges of that are. I think the last time it was just a passing comment about me volunteering to pick up the garbage. But maybe it's worth this group's while to kind of understand the obstacles and kind of the history. Maybe the history of the debate's not necessary, but I'm sure historically when this has been brought up, I'm sure some of the concerns that there have been still apply. I'm not sure that we can cover it right now, but we can start on it. Can we start by answering the question about what have some of the stumbling blocks been to have only necessary traffic in Market Square, whether it's delivery trucks, emergency vehicles, people getting to their residents? What have been some of the problems or stumbling blocks?
I think you just stated them. It's really access, emergency vehicle access, services access, so solid waste, private residence, you know, people getting to their private residences, the businesses, I think one of the great lessons from this experience has been that the roadways can be adjusted and traffic can still function and the areas can still maintain safe traffic, and and so there is some opportunities to adjust the road widths and to do some more street activation, and it does not seem to bring things to a standstill. Complete closures of areas becomes a bigger challenge because people have private driveways they need to get to. There's so you're depriving, you know, private property owners' rights to their buildings. So there needs to be, you know, there need to be a thorough view of those properties and how best to accommodate access to those properties. It's one of those things that you know, some people love it and some people don't love it. It's a real challenge to balance those needs and expectations. But I think the experience that we've had is there's definitely, you know, room for some adjustments out there that, you know, I think people are experiencing that, you know, it's not, you know, we have the ability to have a less pavement in Market Square and still have people get through safely. You know, the challenge with winter operations from our standpoint is really the level of expectation relative to snow removal and then safety related to icy, slippery conditions and, you know, continuing to be able to provide emergency access, you know, for the fire chief's equipment and for our services such as, you know, the solid waste collection and delivery of material stuff for businesses. So, you know, one of the things that you know, Karen had mentioned that staff is going to get together and talk about, you know, how, you know, we can look at, you know, what could we carry through the winter, you know, what types of activities and how could it be accomplished. And that's something that, you know, we need to sit down with the fire chief, the planning director, you know, we'll have the parking, our parking engineer, Eric Eby, involved. And we'll look and, you know, we'll look hard at saying, okay, what can we do? And, you know, part of the challenge is that there's certain areas that are more readily amenable to, you know, making some adjustments. And so you're going to have some winners and then you're going to have some losers. And this has been the challenge throughout this whole process is that some folks have the ability to, you know, put pop-ups in their parking lots. Other people don't have any real estate at all to deal with. And so it becomes a very challenging thing to balance those things out. So, you know, we're looking very hard at this. We understand the need to do all we can to support the businesses, and that's, you know, that's what our job is. Our job is to help facilitate and to keep, you know, the city vibrant, and you know fortunately we're, you know, working with you all has been very good, and we've had good success. So I'm hoping, you know, I'm cautiously optimistic that we can come up with some things we can do this winter. But it obviously won't be everything everybody wants, unless we roll this, get enough snow, roll the streets and have tracked vehicles with sleds types of stuff, which would be awesome. I would love the Vale, you know, give me 10 feet of snow consistently. I'd much rather plow snow than deal with the ice.
Just follow up on Peter's comments and say, you know, we did a couple open streets events last year that gave us some good information. It certainly wasn't the same set situation as COVID. You know, I think some businesses have adjusted a little bit more to their view of ability to use the outside. But the Open Streets event had some certain benefits and certain challenges. One of the things is because we're not a grid street pattern, we have to maintain some traffic flow through Market Square. It's very difficult to route around it. But I think I love when people think big. So I'm the planner, I'm not the practical person. So I'll just say that I think it's great to keep thinking big. And I think we're very lucky to have a public works staff that also, though they have to think practically, can also think big. And I think, you know, this information and that, I love that the health subcommittee is thinking along these lines too. I think that's great that we're all kind of aligning on this idea.
I gotta say, you actually do think practically despite being a planner.
Go ahead, Ann.
There was a screen share a month ago, maybe, showing us the warming stations in Quebec City, and that was really compelling. Mm-hmm. I have a link to that. I didn't know if it had any reality for here, but the pictures sure were amazing. So I don't know, Peter, I'll send it to you if you want to look at it.
We definitely have to talk that through with our fire department.
Yes.
I know. Yeah. I know. Yes. I feel like then when that was shared that
You saw the chief clutch his heart when he saw the picture.
Yeah, we're also talking to a few other communities that have done, besides those darn Canadians, whether there's some comparisons in the States. And you know, because we have to, you know, there's slightly different codes and things that we have to think about. So, but again, we love when people think big, and if there's a way to make that work.
Agreed.
Be great. But, and whatever you want to put on our plate for consideration before Thursday morning will be reviewed.
Yeah, and I think maybe Bianca, if she's still with us, I think we just got off the health call, and I think the, you know, the cold weather, which has resulted people going indoors, presumably has resulted in a spike that we're seeing statewide and also in Portsmouth. And, you know, I'm an optimistic person, but I think there's a lot of people scratching their heads, whether it's in Portsmouth, Boston, New York, nationally, how are independent restaurants and businesses going to survive? You know, it'd be nice if the Congress passed legislation that supported the airlines and restaurants and arts venues. So I think we're all waiting for that sort of help. But it's not happening at the moment. So I think we do need to think big, because I think there's a lot at stake.
Agreed.
All right.
So there we are.
All right. Okay. So looks like we're ready to adjourn.
We are. Good conversation. Okay. And great idea on the Bianca. Thanks for bringing that out.
All right. Thank you very much, everyone.
All right. Let's go think big. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.